This episode of TWA is brought to you by Campfire Blaze.
What a lovely day to cross the street. What happened? Why did the animation style change? Why are all these women suddenly interested in me for no reason? Oh no, I just got isekai'd. Isekai is weeaboo speak that translates to different world, other world, light novel template 01, or a more accurate translation would probably be cash cow. Isekai is a genre frequently found in light novels, manga, anime, and video games, and usually takes the form of some schlub from the modern world who gets transported to a fantasy world. While the genre itself comes from weeaboo land, sometimes confusingly referred to as Japan, there is no reason that any writer can't just use this template as well. And why not? If most light novel authors use every isekai cliche with zero modifications, then so can we. So let's get whisked off to another world to write our very own isekai story. Just, you know, be sure to clean up after isekaiing everywhere. Now, most stories consist of a tripod of elements, namely plot, setting, and character. However, isekai stories, by contrast, only consist of two central pillars, the harem and the power fantasy. Let's start with the harem. Now, a harem is a cutthroat cesspit of political intrigue and exploitation where enslaved women are treated like objects. Wait, sorry, how did these historical notes get into my script? Let me start again. The harem is a collection of girls that can be sorted based on the magnitude of their mammaries, and all possess the singular personality trait of being in love with the protagonist. The best thing about the harem is that it is easy to mix and match to create a huge amount of combinations. For example, we can combine the big boob girl with the older sister archetype, or we could combine the lolly with the cat girl. But it's okay because she's really 1,000 years old, so that makes it fine to put her on a body pillow. There is also a large supply of dereis to choose from as well. These combinations are endless, and the best part is that they're all written nearly exactly the freaking same. Now, I could write them with a personality beyond I'm in love with the self-insert protagonist, which is correct. Be sure to add that extra bit of characterization in the form of slapping the protagonist after mistaking his actions for being lecherous. Accidental sexual harassment is funny! Or how she, for some reason, decides to constantly send mixed signals about her romantic interest in the protagonist while endlessly calling him an idiot. All of the usual anime cliches are excellent in avoiding any deeper characterization. Why make any of the harem girls fleshed out characters when we can just stick to the most stock version of their archetypes? If I give them actual personalities with their own perspective and opinions, they may just decide that my protagonist isn't really all that interesting and they could probably do better for themselves. My ego, my protagonist can't have that. Speaking of the protagonist, how can an isekai writer handle that? Thankfully, isekai protagonists are the easiest protagonists to write. Now, some writers might worry that a protagonist from Japan might be difficult to write for someone who isn't from that country. But see, that is the best thing about isekai protagonists, is that their nationality, culture, and every other aspect of their character is basically as interchangeable and deep as the cardboard packaging the Blu-ray box set arrived in. An isekai protagonist's personality is meant to be as flat as the lolly's chest, so the audience can project themselves onto him without something like character to get in the way. Yes, we could use the protagonist's modern perspective as a way to generate conflict, as his values clash with the societal mores of a strange fantasy culture, or we could force the protagonist to work his way up and have to earn the trust of the locals. But I want my power fantasy now! Now, now, now! There is to be no struggle, hardship, or any other kind of setback for the protagonist. He is just all-powerful all the time. Oh no, does the villain have the protagonist on the ropes? No problem, give him a free power-up. That was close, we almost had some narrative tension there for a second. Now, this may present the problem of the audience struggling to root for a protagonist given his complete lack of a personality beyond his magical ability to stumble into the girl's changing room by accident. Perhaps I should add something to make the protagonist a bit more sympathetic, like contributing to slavery. The protagonist could decide to rescue a cute slave girl by buying her? Like, what? Is that really in the script? Yeah, there it is. That can't be real. No one's dumb enough to write that into their story. Now, a less skilled writer would have had the protagonist systematically destroy the slaver's organization and make sure that the entire institution of exploitation found its way into the dustbin of history where it belongs. This could even be an example of clashing modern ancient perspectives on if a person can be considered property. But no, better to use the system of slave trade to expand the harem, which is the only historically accurate part of an isekai's harem. But hey, let's move on to something less controversial. Like sexual tension between the protagonist and his underage sister. Now, not boning one's sister is like the lowest of the low bars to clear, but if stumbling over this hurdle proves too much for the audience, then just say that the protagonist's sister isn't related by blood, and that makes it all okay. Somehow. Or, you know, a writer could always just never specify any blood relations. The important thing to remember is that it's not a really isekai story unless it has hentai search terms added to it. Now that an isekai writer has sated their lust for power, lust for their harem, and lust for their sister, that must mean that we are done, right? Wrong. Unfortunately, all this lust still can exist in a vacuum. I mean, you know, unless it's a science fiction anime. But isekai isn't isekai unless it takes place in another world. This must mean that an isekai writer has to set aside their lust for just a few moments in order to create a setting. And there is only one thing powerful enough to make them forget about their lecherousness even for a moment. Video games! Just add video game mechanics to the isekai world. How do video game RPG mechanics influence a world's social, economic, military, and political systems? I have no idea, but it sure is cool to have the protagonist level up when he kills a monster. Yes, the bandits concede the protagonist is overpowered and can even see his stats, but they will still pick a fight with him regardless. Wow, the protagonist didn't even need to pay to win! Wouldn't the world be ruled by overleveled, superpowered characters who have the best stats and loot? Wouldn't that also mean that these superpowered characters would control access to all of the best areas to level up, as well as monopolize the best loot drops in order to maintain their power? Wouldn't that make for a compelling story as the protagonist is forced to grind in order to overthrow characters who are gaming the system? Oh no, can't have any of that. A lot of isekai doesn't even have a central villain, much less a cabal of villains who actually know what they're doing. Or, like, have a story arc, or, like, an overall structure? Nope, it's just the protagonist wandering around, being awesome, and defeating the occasional monster or bandit. The rest is just romantic comedy hijinks that we've seen a billion times in other anime. Don't forget the hot springs and beach episodes. That'll sell a few extra body pillows. Does this isekai world have any political system at all? How would these fantasy nations react to dealing with strange individuals from a completely alien world who are basically walking weapons of mass destruction? Wouldn't kingdoms and empires try to woo the protagonist to their side and feed them propaganda in order to control them for their own strategic advantage? Or, you know, give them an actual harem to bribe them to their side? Wouldn't a team with superpowers be hopelessly out of their depth when navigating court intrigue? These would all be good questions if they didn't get in the way of my naked power fantasy. This is the core problem. Isekai should never develop its setting to generate interesting conflict that forces the protagonist to develop. Instead, we should develop our setting to generate loot and XP, so my protagonist can have even more power. Now that we have a setting that is entirely conductive to the protagonist's endless lust, how are we going to get him there? Why with Truck-kun, obviously. Notice me, semi, or don't if you're the protagonist. You would think that Japan would start passing safe driving regulations given how many young men keep getting killed by trucks, but getting splatted by traffic is still the best method for getting someone into fantasy land. I mean, there is, like, a billion other ways we could get our protagonists to the fantasy world while also kickstarting the plot at the same time. For example, they could learn magic for the first time and accidentally transport themselves to another world. They could be dying of an incurable disease in a hospital, and their last dying wish would be to be given a second chance, only for a magical entity to offer them said chance, but at the price of enduring a dangerous adventure. There could be a mysterious portal in the basement that the protagonist's parents used to flee the fantasy world because it's really dangerous there. The protagonist's powers were so overpowered that they are considered a weapon of mass destruction in the magic world. So they were hidden away on Earth where magic doesn't work. That is, until one day, bad guys from the magic world abduct the protagonist from Earth and drag them into the magic world as a political bargaining chip. An evil spirit lies to the protagonist about what a fun time they will have in a world full of magic, And all they have to do is sign their name in blood on this mysterious book, and they will totally get transported to a fun fantasy world and most definitely not become this entity's pawn in its grand game against the gods. The protagonist builds a portal out of science! And then enters it for science! And then they help this fantasy world full of magic by using science! A monster from the fantasy world shows up and eats the protagonist to gain his delicious magic potential. It turns out the protagonist's best friend is in fact the magic world's chosen one, and they just get pulled in for the ride during the magical crossfire when the bad guys try to abduct their friend from the normal world. The protagonist gets pulled into the fantasy world only when they dream, and they return to the normal world when they wake up, forcing them to live a double life, and even begin to doubt which world is the dream. The entire genre of fantasy role-playing games was made by a powerful entity searching for a champion. It finds that champion when the protagonist is the only person to beat the world's hardest RPG, like a fantasy version of The Last Starfighter. A wardrobe leads to Jesus Lion. The protagonist is delivered to the wrong afterlife. The school's magic club turns out to be a front for recruitment in the war against the Dark Lord. Join the magic armed forces, see new worlds, kill exciting new orcs. A hacker discovers a hidden world of magic on the web. Or, I don't know, while avoiding an out-of-control truck, a dragon runs over the protagonist instead. None of these will work because that requires the author to pay more attention than the driver of Truck Coon. The important thing to consider is that the opening transition for the protagonist's old life to the new fantasy world be completely perfunctory and not try to do something stupid like start the plot, foreshadow the primary conflict, or establish a central theme. Plus, it might also jar light novel readers from their power fantasy-induced stupor. We can't stress out our audiences, and instead we should keep feeding them the anime equivalent of junk food. Besides, if we need a variation on an isekai story, then I can always just say that the protagonist is whisked off to another world, but this time, I have my cell phone! And no bars. Man, reception is terrible in Fantasyland. They really need to install some Wi-Fi there or something.
Our fortress of eternal integrity has fallen to the very hands of greed. Clearly, the sponsorship wars have escalated beyond our ability to contain. Our tactics are no longer sufficient to curtail such wanted selling out by the TWA Expanded Universe factions. We must pull out all the stops.
You don't mean...
Yes, we must use our ultimate weapon, the final stern warning.
Look, I may just be the new guy here, but might I suggest trying something different? Like, your fortress just got nommed by eldritch hand monsters. I think we are a little beyond issuing warnings, stern, final, or otherwise, at this point.
Commander, the very trustworthy new guy has a point. Perhaps we should try something more direct to try to contain the situation.
You are both right. The apocalypse is upon us, as was foretold. There's only one thing that can drive away the ads now. There's only one thing so destructive and vile that no advertiser, however desperate, will ever want to touch the TWA Expanded Universe again.
You can't mean...
Yes, we must say the forbidden naughty word.
But muttering the forbidden word could lead to the entire TWA universe getting cancelled. It could very well be the end of everything.
It's a risk we will have to take.
So, does anyone know what the forbidden word actually is?
No, JP won't tell me. You know how cagey he gets about stuff like that. Therefore, we have only one option. We must go through every word in the dictionary until we find it. Starting now.
While those fools are busy, I can claim this video sponsor, Campfire Blaze's power for myself. Campfire Blaze is a browser-based writing organizational tool to help aspiring authors, dungeon masters, and most importantly, shadowy cabals to keep their plots straight. Campfire Blaze allows conspirators, and I suppose writers as well, to organize their plots using timelines to help visualize the plot's flow. And trust me, when you have as many plots as I do, it really helps to keep everyone on the same page. Why, me and my fellow conspirators can even collaborate to help flesh out our schemes in real time.
Not to mention the word processor, character sheets, character arcs, relationship details, and even tools to flesh out magic systems, languages, and artifacts. Try the free version or build your own subscription by choosing only the modules you need by going to bit.ly/TWAblaze. TWA fans can also use the code TWA21 at checkout to receive 20% off all lifetime purchases of Blaze modules. Link is in the description below. Sir New Guy, what are you doing there? Nothing, just, you know, making sure this nefarious ad doesn't try anything, nefarious. Since, you know, it seems we're going to be here a while.